इतमस्तुमा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते। शांति शांति शांति। ओम आप्यायन्तु ममांगानि वाक् प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथो वयमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्म उपनिषदं माहं ब्रह्म निराकुर्याम् मामा ब्रह्म निराकरोद् अनिराकरणमस्त्व निराकरणं मे अस्तु। तदात्मनि निरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शङ्करं लोकशङ्करं शङ्करं शङ्कराचार्यं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः। ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ॐमित्येतदक्षरमुद्गीतमुपासीत ॐमिति ह्युद्गायते तस्योपव्याख्यानम्। संकल्पादेव तु तच्छ्रुतेः पूर्वाधिकरणेषु परविद्याकुलम् अभिधाय अली अधिकरण दि रिजल्ट ऑफ दि परविद्या ब्रह्म विद्या दिस इज जीवन मुक्ति दैट वाज स्टेटेड। अपर विद्याकुलम् प्रपंच एदम् रिजल्ट ऑफ दि मेडिटेशन अपॉन सगुण ब्रह्म विच इज अटेनमेंट ऑफ ब्रह्म लोक एंड द एंजॉयमेंट द प्लेजर्स देयर for the wise person are now being explained or delineated. Sankalpadevatu tachyate. Harada vidyayam shruyate. Indhara vidyaya is said, sadhi pitulokama bhavati sankalpadevasya pitara samuttishthanti iti ityadi. If he desires to have association with his father or the ancestors, then merely by the will, his father or whatever he wills will appear before him. So sankalpat eva, that's the thing. So sankalpat eva samuttishthanti, sankalpat samuttishthanti eva, depending on where you put the eva kara. Sankalpat eva samuttishthanti, that's what the reading is. Merely by sankalpa, merely by his will or the wish, that the objects desired by him appears before him. We place evakara elsewhere. Sankalpad pitara samuttishthanti eva. So when he has a sankalpa or a desire, then the pitaraha, the ancestors, the parents will definitely appear before him. Even case sankalpa eva, merely by sankalpa. So that is the anya yoga vivachedaha, meaning that there is nothing other than sankalpa required. Whereas sankalpa samutishthandeva, then my sankalpa, they definitely appear. There is a possibility of factors other than sankalpa also. So ayoga vivachela and anya yoga vivachela. Ayoga, that sankalpa is definitely required. Not that something else is not required. Anya yoga vivachela means that nothing other than sankalpa is required. So these two possible explanations are there for the evakara. And that's how the samshaya arises. So doubt arises. Kim sankalpa eva kevala pitraya samuthaya hetu? Is it merely sankalpa that is a hetu, the cause or the means required for the appearance of the desirable object? Uta nimittantara sahita hetu? Or the sankalpa also requires some other means to fulfill itself? Is sankalpa enough to fulfill the desire of enjoyment of the desirable object, or that this upasaka or wise person also requires something over and above sankalpa to fulfill his wish? Tatra sati eva sankalpat eva iti shravana. Even though shruti is clear, sankalpat eva, of which the meaning is merely by sankalpa. Lokavat nimittantara pekshara yukta, but in the world we do not find that anything can be accomplished merely by wish. It is not our experience in our day-to-day life that something accomplished merely by wish. Yatha loke asmadadinam sankalpat gamanadibhyasyetubhyah. In our day-to-day life, if you want to meet your father, then not only you have the desire to meet the father, but you must go where father is, or father should come where you are. Some governance, some movement, some travel is required in this particular instance. Depending upon the object of desire, you may require different kinds of means. If it's a modaka, you require different kinds of means. But after having desire, then also you should do what is required for you to enjoy modaka. Otherwise it will be merely kalpana, an imagination, which also may give some kind of joy. But the real joy of eating the modaka will not be there unless a tangible modaka is there. And therefore, merely wish cannot create a tangible object. A merely wish in the mind can create a mental object, which also does give you a certain kind of joy, which is what we call priya. The joy arising out of thinking of a desirable object. The joy that you want of experiencing it, that pushkara, or that sense of fulfillment that you want, the abundant joy that you want will not come merely by an object at the level of mind. This is our experience in our day-to-day life. Evam muktasyapisyat. So whether mukta, a liberated person, is different from us, or he also has to be judged by the criteria that we experience in our day-to-day life. Evam drishti viparitam na kalpitam bhavishyate. Purvapakshi says that the advantage of saying that you require something over and above a sankalpa also is, will be then in keeping with what we experience, and you do not have to imagine something quite different from our experience. Our experience is that merely a wish does not create a tangible object. If you want to say that in case of this wise person, it is merely what desire or the will that he requires, that means the will creates a tangible object. In which case you have to imagine something different from what our experience is. Sankalpa devidu Ragneva. Then why does Upanishad say that merely by will? It says more or less by will. Ragneva, just as a king, all he requires is desire, and everything presents itself to him. And so, Sankalpitartha Siddhikarim Sarasa Sadhanandra Samagin Sulabham Apeksha Uchyate. For a king, all that he requires is to express a desire. That I want to have, I want to enjoy this, I want this food, I want to watch this movie, whatever it is. I want to play this game. All a king requires is to simply express a desire. And now everything automatically gathers around him for him to fulfill his desire. So king requires a desire and other also nimitta or other factors which are very easily available for fulfilling the desire. So also we can imagine that for the wise person he desires and all other factors required for fulfilling the desire are easily available. With that in mind, Shruti says that all he requires is sankalpa or will. That is sankalpa tasamutthana pitradeha manodavijrumvitavat charatva puskalam bhogam samarpayitam pariyaptaha syuhiti. So manodavata vijrumvitavat charatva. Like a modaka, we simply imagine the mind. How long will it remain in your mind? For a while. Mind being flickering, unsteady, therefore, it cannot steadily sustain any object. So you can enjoy a modaka as long as modaka remains in your mind. Nothing, even the mental enjoyment also can come as long as modaka is there in your mind, not later. Therefore, for this wise person also to enjoy an object to his heart's content, he requires a tangible object. And therefore, to convert his desire into a tangible object, you require factors over and above his desire. Wants to have a house, all right. Then if he is a very wealthy person, the house will be easily constructed, the architects will come, this will come, they will design, all permissions will come, all materials will come. In no time a house will be constructed, but he will require factors over and above his desire for a tangible house for him to live. If he is merely at the level of mind, then he imagines a house and thinks that this is my room and that is father's room. Like children, you know, we are making the pack of cards. So we will make a palace or a big house. So daddy, this is your bedroom. Mom, this is your bedroom. This is my room. So it's all imagination. You can have the pleasure of an imagination, but not pleasure of actually living in it. That will require a tangible house, and that will require factors over and above your sankalpa. But for the wise person, Brahmaloka, everything is easily available. In that sense, Upanishad says that all you require is sankalpa, the will. Evam prapte brumaha. When this interpretation is possible, Sankalpa devatu pitaraha kevalat pitradi samusthanamiti. Then we say there is nearly my sankalpa, nothing more than sankalpa, that desired object such as pitaraha, they appear before him. He has association with them. Kutaha, how can it be? That's not our experience. That Shruti, because that is what the Shruti says. Sankalpa devasya pitara samuttishtanti ityadikaya Shruti nimittantara pekshayam pidiyata. If that statement is qualified by saying that even though the Shruti says that all you require is will, but in order for you to conform to your day-to-day experience, you interpret that by saying that, no, you require other factors also, then you're compromising the interpretation of the Shruti. You're not interpreting a statement in the primary sense, you are compromising, meaning interpreting that in a secondary sense. when separation in primary sense is possible, you should not go for a figurative meaning or a secondary sense. Nimittantara pitu yadi sankalpa anuvidhaye eva syat bhavatu. We say that you require factors other than his will. If those factors also appear before him by his will, so let there be a house design, and so the plans appear before him. Let there be municipal permission appears before him. Let a structure engineer now design it, okay. Let the construction crew come, you know, that as he thinks, then things happen. If this is what you mean, meaning that as he desires, things happen. There is no gap or distance between his desire and happening. Then only it's called Satya Sankalpa, it is called the unfailing will. Otherwise, he desires. Then he has to wait for the permission to become a municipal corporation. That will be infinite. I mean, under his lifetime will require for that to happen. And so, what I'm saying is that if he also has to wait like that, and then what's the use of saying that merely by will he gets it? Then, prak sampatte vandya sankalpatva prasangat. That means that until the time that he makes sankalpa, there is a gap between his making sankalpa and fulfill of sankalpa, during that time, he is devoid of the fulfillment of his sankalpa. That is what? Sankalpa vandya prasangat. Or vandya sankalpa prasangat. His sankalpa is not fructified. Then it will not be called satya sankalpa. Satya sankalpa is unfailing will. It must be fructified right away. Naja shruti avagamyate lokavadi samanyata dushtam kramate. When the Shruti can be interpreted in the primary sense, then you don't have to compromise the Shruti by bringing in our experiences, comparing a wise person with us, and imagining. This is a lot of problem we have. We always look upon others as we are. And what is not possible cannot be possible for that person. You can't say that. You cannot do that. And most people cannot do that. You have not seen anybody doing it, okay? That does not mean it cannot be done, because Shastra says that. And therefore, Nacha Shruti Avagamyate, when Shruti can be interpreted in the primary sense, then you don't compromise it by bringing this local logic. Sankalapaladayatrachesham yavapravajam sthariyopatte. We say that what is created by the mind is always fleeting, it is not steady. He says, no. On the strength of his sankalpa, his modaka will be steady. Will be there until he enjoys it. It takes 10 minutes to enjoy that modaka and then it remains for 10 minutes. Sankalpa bala, because of the power of his sankalpa. Prakrita sankalpa lakshanatvat mukta sankalpasya. That's the whole idea. The sankalpa of a wise person. So whose will has been strengthened, made powerful on account of a long time meditation. Meditation, concentration of the mind. So by concentrating the mind upon Saguna Brahma for a great length of time, the capacity of the mind has been, in fact, invoked. The mind has variety of potential. That's the idea. When Yogi Shastra and other scriptures talk about the divine powers and things like that, it means that the mind has the potential that these powers are hidden in the mind. It is possible for someone to explore or make these powers manifest. Possible. That being the case, yes, you must have the preparation, yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, to tell you how to qualify for that. Maybe everybody will not get it. But if you go by the route that is qualified, specified by that, the live life of Yama and Niyama, then asana, tune up your body, then pranayama, tune up your pranas, then concentration dharana, then meditation, and then samadhi, absorption. So these are the steps that are specified there, that are taught there. You follow this, then you will have the result that they claim or they describe. Now continue page 897. Sri Ratna Prabha, Namu Ishwaradhinasya Vidusha Katam Sankalamatra Bhoga Siddhi. Ishwaradhinasya Vidusha. Even a wise person also is dependent upon Ishvara for fulfillment of his desire. So Daivam is always required. Here Prayatna is not required. But Daivam, he says, okay, all Prayatna is, all he requires is his will or desire. But still, a desire to fulfill provided there is grace of Ishvara, otherwise even a desire of a wise person also cannot be fulfilled. This is a Puru Paksha. Ishvara Adhinasya Vidushaya. Idea is that whoever is born is always controlled by the laws of Ishvara. Because your body, your sense organs, your mind, all of these are limited entities. And all these limited entities function in accordance with the laws of Ishvara. So, Vidushaha Ishvara Adhinasya. We know very well that even a person who is alive, you know, who is liberated while living, even Jivan Mukta also has limitations as far as the body, etc. are concerned. There are limitations, the mind, they are limited entities. And he also has to manifest through these limited entities, and therefore, that manifestation of his powers or manifestation of faculties will be limited by the faculties. Therefore, Ishvara Adhinasya Vidushaha. So how about the Vidwan and Brahmaloka? There also there will be laws. So even if he is in Brahmaloka, there also he will be controlled or dependent upon Ishvara's anugraha. Sankala Matra Katham Bhoga Siddhi. How is it possible? Meaning that, all right, even if you do not require other factors, for building a house, etc., you do not require what an ordinary person requires in terms of the material, etc. That a wise person that in Brahmaloka desires a house and house is, appears before him, all right. But then also one factor is required, and that is Ishvara Anugraha. Even that also requires a fear of Ishvara. And therefore, you cannot say that only his sankalpa is required, Ishvara Anugraha also is required. This is a Puru Paksha. Kadam Sankala Matra Bhoga Siddhiti. Then how can you say that the accomplishment of bhoga or the pleasure is merely by sankalpa, by will? How do you say? Or as Nyayana says, Vidushaya satya sankalpe labhantaram aha. That since this, by wise person we mean the person who has realized the results of the meditation. He is also called wise person. Wise as far as the Saguna Brahma is concerned. Normally we use the expression wise person for the one who has known Brahman in his own self. But here, even the person who has reached Brahmaloka also is described as Vidwan, because Vidya is twofold, Brahma Vidya, Paravidya and Aparavidya. For both of them the word Vidya is employed. So, Paravidya means Brahma Vidya, knowledge of Brahman as one's own self. Apara Vidya is the then the meditation upon Saguna Brahma, there, which is identification with Saguna Brahma. So Paravidya means identification with Param Brahma, and Aparavidya means the culmination of Aparavidya is identification with Saguna Brahma. So we are talking about this rare upasaka who has performed the upasana. Of what quality and for what length of time that he became identified with Saguna Brahma. So there are, we hear about some upasakas. Moraya, Ganapati Bappa, Moraya. What is this Moraya? What does it mean? It says that is what comes from when Moropant, few hundred years ago, was a great bhakta of Lord Ganesha. So he must be one who accomplished the identification with Moraya, I mean with Ganapati. Became Ganapati. And therefore he is praised as much as Ganapati is praised. So he joined along with Ganapati Moraya. So we do hear of this kind of great devotees or, you know, of Hanuman, of Ganapati, of Devi, and they display many divine powers. So there are some, not very many, but there are definitely rare upasakas or devotees of Saguna Brahma who we know have accomplished those divine powers. Become, so the powers of the Devata manifest through them, let me say it here. So here he says also labhantara, what's other labha ataheva? So next sutra says, अथा एव च अनन्याधिपतिः अतः एव च अनन्य अधिपतिः अत एव च सत्य संकल्पादेव च अतः बिकॉज ऑफ दैट मीनिंग बिकॉज दिस वन हैज नाउ अटेन्ड द स्टेट ऑफ बीइंग सत्य संकल्प और वन हु इज बिकॉज ही हैज बीन मेडिटेटिंग अपॉन ब्रह्मन एज सत्य संकल्प Satya Kamaha, Satya Sangalpa. So this is the qualification of Saguna Brahma. And by meditating he has become that. So he also becomes Satya Kamaha, Satya Sangalpa. So Atahiva, Satya Sangalpa Tvadeva, Ananya Adipatihi, Anya Adipatihi, Navidyate Yasedi, Ananya Adipatihi, one, he becomes one, for whom there is no other Lord to rule over him. Yadi vidusha anyadipati syat. Why do you say that? Because if this vidwan also has to depend upon the grace of Ishvara, taita adhina bhogasya sangramata sadhyatva bhavat, then bhoga that he wants will not be accomplished merely by his sankalpa. Whatever sankalpa, he also requires the Ishvara anugraha or daivam or the grace of Ishvara, which is unpredictable. Satya Sankalpatvam Nasyat, then Vidwan Kram, because Satya Sankalpa, one of unfailing will or unfailing desire. Atha Vidushaya Sankalpadeva Sarva Ishwarya Prapti. Therefore, Vidwan attains all the Ishwarya by merely his Sankalpa on the will. So this is the Siddhanta here. This is Jnaninaya Upasitu. Ishwaragina bhogo, the sinkala matra, the alamiti asankya, sutram vyaga. So this is a purupaksha, imagine purupaksha. Sometimes purupaksha is stated, sometimes it is assumed that it is there. Upasitu ishwaragina bhoga. Purupakshi says that for the upasaka, his bhoga enjoyment is still dependent upon Ishwara. It may not be dependent upon other factors. But one more factor did not take into account, that is the grace of Ishvara. The sankala matra bhavitum alam, therefore, the bhoga, or the ultimate culmination of sankalpa, in terms of actually experiencing the object of desire, will not be by his will, it also requires Ishvaranugraha. Iti asankhya. This shankha, then the sutra replies. The shankha or the doubt, the sutra addresses. Ataha. So, Vashyakara says, Ataha eva cha. So, these words come from the sutra. So, what's the meaning of Ataha eva? Says, Avandya sankalpatvat. Ataha is the reason. And so, here the cause is given, or the hetu is given, avadhya sankalpatvat, because his sankalpa is avadhya, unfailing. It always fructifies. Because sankalpa of this upasaka, wise person, is unfailing, always fructifies. Therefore, says Vashya, ananyadipatihi vidvan bhavate na asya anyaha adhipatir bhavate ityartha. Therefore, ananyadipatihi bhavate. Adhipati means Ishvara. Anyadipati, one who has other lord. Ananyadipati, one who has no lord. Meaning, one is no ruler. Nobody to control him. Ananyadipati bhavati. He says, Svatantra bhavati. He becomes Svatantra. Svatantra means he controls himself. He is not controlled by anybody else. Sarvatantra Svatantra. One is not controlled by any tantra at all. So it's called Sarvatantra Svatantra. Sarvatantra Svatantra. Sadatma, Dvaita Veda, etc. So here he becomes Sarvatantra Svatantra. He's not controlled by any rules. No rules apply to him. That's what it means. Vidvan Bhavati Nasya Anya Adhipati Bhavati Ityartha. He does not have any other lord or ruler over him. Meaning that if you have a ruler over you, then all the rules apply to you. Then whatever you do is within the rules also. Whenever Swamiji used to talk about the order, understand that you are born in the order. Your birth also is according to the order. Even the rules. Even birth also cannot take place outside of the rules. And that you grow and you are what you are is all within the order. You are whatever you are. You are a good person, that also is because of the order. You are a bad person, that also is because of the order only. That is not order, is not right. Order means according to rules. So there are rules. That if you violate, then you get violated, and then you take tendency of further violation. That's how you keep on slipping. And there are rakshasim, asurim cheva, prakrutim, mohinim shitaha. You come under the sway of rakshasi prakruti, asuri prakruti, but there is also a rule. There is rajoguna, there is tamoguna, there is sattvaguna. If you do not, with a great effort, try to get established in sattva-guna, then the rajo-guna will pull you, asuri-prakriti, tamo-guna will be rakshasi-prakriti, will pull you. Meaning that everything takes place within the framework of law of Ishvara. So therefore says ananyadipati, here is a person now who is not ruled by any rules. To whom? These rules or laws do not apply. This is a big statement. Big statement. It says, Nyayana Satya Sankalpatvevi Kada Ishvara Adhinatma Vidushanna Ishvara. All right. We accept that wise person is Satya Sankalpa or is the unfailing will, the person of unfailing will. But in what way does it contradict being ruled by Ishvara? Is it not possible that both of them coexist? That he is the one of unfailing will, at the same time, He is also ruled by the laws of Ishvara. Why not? Why can't these two things coexist? So, nahi. Says Bhashyakara, nahi prakrutopi sankalpayanna anyasvamikatvam atmanaha satyam gatau sankalpayate. Prakrutopi. Even a prakruta, even a samsari, an ordinary person. Prakruta means one is controlled by prakruti. Prakruta means an ignorant person. So even our day-to-day ignorant person also, sankalpa, when he also desires something, satyam gatav, if he has a choice, then anyasvamikattvam atmanaha na sankalpayati na anyasvamikattvam svamikattvam atmana sankalpayati. Even a day-to-day ordinary person also does not want that somebody else should rule him. Anyasvamitva means what? That should be ruled by someone else, controlled by someone else, lorded over by someone else. Even an ordinary person doesn't want. Even a child doesn't want that you should hold its finger. It wants to go independently. You know, as long as it could not do so long, you know. So long, okay, he allowed. He was fellow while walking, you know. Now that he can walk on his own, he doesn't want anyone to hold his finger. So even ordinary person also doesn't want that he should be ruled by. Then he's ruled by the different, you know, nobody wants it. Nobody wants to be controlled by somebody else, ruled by somebody else. Nobody wants to be dependent. Everybody loves freedom or independence. So love for freedom or independence is very natural to everybody. When that is so, then it must be accomplished. Meaning that there is constant desire to become free, meaning free from all rules and regulations also. That's how people interpret freedom anyway. These days, people think that freedom means a license to do what you want to do. So, no rules and no regulations. Marriage, no rules. We'll live together. Child, no rules. We'll have it, we'll not have it. So, they do not want to follow any rules. Because it's a restriction. We don't want to restrict it. I always want to have a choice of my own. Choice to do what I want. Once you get married, then you are bound in a structure, then you can't do what you want to do. You have to come home in time and stuff like that, somebody will ask you. And he doesn't want that. That it doesn't work is a different matter. Then for the other person also doesn't want to be controlled. Then you have two persons who don't want to control, then they can't be together. Being together means that you have to let go of something and allow yourself to be controlled in some way. If you don't, then you can't, there cannot be an assembly, you cannot live together, can't sit together. You want to stand and you want to listen to standing, you know, or you want to listen while walking. These kind of things, you know, don't work. So anytime we do something, we have to conform to the laws. Our desire is not to conform if you had a choice. Satyam gatav. Gati means a choice here. You know, if you have some other way of doing it, so then you would avoid it. So, na anyasvamikattvam atmanah sankalpayate. Even ordinary person also does not wish that he should be controlled by someone else as if he had a choice. He has no choice, that's a different thing. Person doesn't have a choice and therefore he accepts being controlled by the laws of society, for example. In this eastern part of the world, like India is that oriental, in the society, laws of society control the person. So western people threw that away. We don't control the laws of society. There's no caste system, no system. They also accept a marriage system. That also is coming under mixed strain because that also is that also compromises my freedom I don't want. So they still have something like contract marriage, you know. then we will be married up to this many years with these conditions. Then we'll see. But here living together, this, that, you know, so that shows a basic desire of a human being to assert its freedom. Nobody is free. You know, assert your freedom as far as the external rules are concerned. Your own imposer are controlling you anyway, so that's not real freedom, but anyway, people think there's some freedom. Says Anandagiri, Ishwar prasadat bhogasyaritavi prathayamano jano dushyadevi. Says, we do fine. The people always say, God, please fulfill my desire. God, please fulfill my desire. So we find people praying. Why do you say that he doesn't want even Ishvara's will? He says, satyam gato. If he was capable of fulfilling his desire, he will not depend upon anybody. That's the idea. Some people are fiercely independent. At the age of 90 also, they live on their own. My mother, she cooks. She cleans. She doesn't want any servant house. Satyam gato. As long as my body permits me, as long as I can do, I will not depend upon anybody. We pray, oh Lord, please fulfill my desire because I find myself incapable of fulfilling my desire. Where I am capable, I do not seek any help, even Ishvara's help. Where I find I am not capable, then I seek help. And when the worldly help is not adequate, then I seek Ishvara's help. So, satyam gatav. As long as I can avoid it, I will not seek any help. When I cannot avoid, then only we seek help. So, this being the case, even in the day-to-day life, what do you talk about this wise person? That he would not want, need any help. Vidushaya. So says Ratnava, Ishvara Dharma Eva, Vidushi Avirbhutayate, the Sankala Vangahiri Bhava. Ishvara is Satya Sankalpa. Ishvara is unfailing will. Atma is Satya Sankalpa. And this person has meditated upon Satya Sankalpa for so long that even though Satya Sankalpa or being one of unfailing will is Ishvara Dharma, not a Jiva Dharma. But Jiva, on account of constantly dwelling upon that, that Ishvara Dharma becomes manifest in Jiva also. So whatever dharmas we have are all Ishvaras anyway. Yadyad vibhuti matsattvam srimadurjitameva tattadevavagacchattvam mama tejamsa sambhavam. When you find a vibhuti glory, when you find any wealth, richness, beauty, splendor, power, energy, urjitam, know that it is a fraction of my own glory. So whatever glory we enjoy, Ishvara's glory anyway. So that is our rupa, whatever upasana we have done. And we are doing. That is what brings into manifestation Ishvara's glory, because glory only belongs to Ishvara. And the extent to which we identify with Ishvara, to that extent, the glory of Ishvara manifests to us. So Ishvara Dharma eva vidushi avirbhuta hete. So when Vidwan is Satya Sankalpa, it is not that it is devoid of Ishvara, but now Ishvara Dharma has come into it. That way it doesn't require now any help from Ishvara. If you require help, then of course you are dependent. He does not require help from Ishvara because Ishvara Dharma, which is Satya Sankalpatvam, being one, having unfailing will, has now manifested in him. Therefore he has become free even from dependent upon Ishvara, anyadipadhi bhavati. Vidushaha ananyadhinam aishvaramasti dhyatra manamaha. All right. That this upasaka has the aishvarya or the powers which are independent of the Ishvara ananyadhinam aishwaryam. That he has the powers which are not dependent upon anybody else, for that manam, the Shruti says that. So Vashyakara says, Shrutischa etad darshayate athaya iha atmanam anuvidya prajante etam sasatyan kaman teshu sarveshu lokeshu kamacharo bhavate iti. Shrutischa etad darshayate. Shruti also shows this. What? This means what? Anyadipatitvam. That a wise person, upasaka, has become independent of any other ruler, is what Shruti says. So, ye iha atmanam anuvidya vrijante. So, those who meditate upon atma, esha atma, apaharapatma, vijaya vimrityu, those who meditate upon atma suggest that in satya kama, satya sankalpa, anuvidya vrijante. Having realized that atma, sugana brahma, here in this world life, and then depart from this body. Etamsa satyan kaman, and all these unfailing desires, or unfailing objects of desire, all of these are also contained in atma. So when he has realized atma as satya kama, satya sankalpa, automatically all the desirable objects also are realized by him, because they are contained in atma. So etamsa satyan kaman anuvidya, having known them, identified with them, tesham sarveshu lokeshu kamacharo bhavati, they have a freedom of movement in all the realms. Like say Narada has license, wherever he wants to go. He wants to go to heaven, wants to go to Brahmaloka, wants to go to Vishnuloka, wants to go to Vraja. So Lord Krishna is to keep on dispatching him again and again. Go to Vraja and find out what the gopis are doing. And go to Hastinapur and see what Pandavas are doing. Let me have all the information. He would go and come back. So just as he had the freedom of movement, wherever he wanted to go. Similarly also, Upasaka has freedom of movement in all the realms. So if he wants to enjoy Yamuna, right away he goes there, he's there. He wants to take a bath in Ganga, right there. Not that he has to travel for 15 days to reach Ganga, then no. Sarveshu lokeshu kamacharo bhavati. So what is atha in that statement is jnana, right? Vidya anuvada dvara tattharokti arambha atha shabda. Atha, meaning that the meditation has been described, and now the result of meditation is being described, for that day what atha is there in the Shruti. That's what jnana says. Okay. So that completes one adhikarana, sankalpa adhikarana consisting of two sutras. Now we go to the next adhikarana. Aham badarhi aha hi evam. Understand that here first two sutras are Purvapaksha sutras. The sutra 10 and 11 are Purvapaksha sutras. And 12 is the Siddhanta Sutra, that also we should understand, otherwise we won't know. So, this Adhikarana comes of 5 sutras. The Vyasika Jnanavala says here, vyavasthita vaichiko vaichiko va bhava bhavau tanuryatah विरुद्धो तेन पुंभेदात् उभौस्याताम् व्यवस्थितौ। एकस्मिन् विपुंसेताओ एतौ ऐच्छिकी कालभेदतः अविरुद्ध स्वप्न जागृतवत् भोगवत् युज्यते, स्वप्न जागृत भोगवत् युज्यते द्विधा। So says here, manasa etan kaman pashyan ramate. Eya ete brahmaloke. In Chandogya later on we'll see. Manasa etan kaman pashyan ramate. Ramate he revels. Etan kaman pashyan manasa. Realizing all these objects of pleasure. He revels. He sports. Meaning that he revels or sports or enjoys the objects of pleasure, such as a wife, such as a child, such as a friend, such as a game, whatever it is that he wants to enjoy. Manasa, Upanishad says that he is simply by the mind that etan kaman pashyan ramate. And so he realizes all those objects of pleasure in the mind and he enjoys them. Yete brahmaloke. It is brahmaloka, all the bhogas, all the objects, all the happiness, the pleasure is only by sankalpa. That's all in brahmaloka. In brahmaloka, you don't have anything else. In brahmaloka, all bhogas are sankalpa maya. Everybody who is there may have own sankalpa. And accordingly, bhogas are there, not there. Like Svarga, etc., there are specific objects that you enjoy, then whatever you wish, that you can enjoy in Brahmaloka. Iti manasam bhogam upapadayanti shruti. So this statement Shruti says, manasam bhogam. This person in Brahmaloka is able to enjoy the objects of pleasure merely in his mind. Only requires is his mind to enjoy those pleasures. He doesn't require sense organs. He doesn't, suppose you want to have modaka. You do not need the organ of perception of taste. Merely by mind you can enjoy. So the pleasure and enjoyment that you get by actually eating a laddu or modaka, you can enjoy that simply by mind. That's why manasa etan kaman pashyan ramate. That's what it says. All it requires is simply those kamas or objects of desire in his mind. Iti manasam bhogam upapadayanti shruti. So this shruti, which in fact prescribes or delineates the bhoga only at the level of the mind. Bahya deyasya sindeyasya abhava. Means that this wise person does not require this external body along with the sense organ, doesn't require. See, we require these things to enjoy objects. We require a body along with sense organs, eyes and ears and whatever. Then alone we can have a contact with the objects of pleasure. Then only we can enjoy. No doubt we do require mind. But we also require, the mind also requires, you know, that Vishayaka Vritti must take place. And for that, Vishaya must be there. And the mind reaching out through the aperture of the sense organ must contact the Vishaya of the object. Thus, Vishayakaya Vritti, a thought of the object, takes place. That is called experience or enjoyment. So, we require not only mind, but we require sense organs also. And sense organs require this body. So, therefore, for this wise person, however, Dehasya sindhyasya abhavaha, that he accomplishes enjoyment merely by the mind, seems to suggest that he does not have the need of an external body as well as sense organs. So this is what the Shruti says in one place. Elsewhere it says, sa ekadha bhavati, tridha bhavati, panchadha bhavati. He remains one. He becomes threefold, he becomes fivefold. Meaning that he can enter in three bodies, five bodies, and simultaneously enjoy things. That's also what the Shruti says elsewhere. Chandogya says in the 7th chapter, it said actually. In the Bhuma Prakranam, while describing, this is the result of the Saguna Brahma Vidya, but this was stated in the context of Nirguna Brahma also, that this wise person, Ekadavodhi, Tridavodhi, Panchadavodhi, etc., he becomes like Ishvara, becomes so calm, that Bahusyan, may become many, he becomes many. So wise person also becomes one-fold, three-fold, five-fold, many-fold. In this Shruti, Deha Sadbhavam Brute. Now one-fold is what? And three-fold is what? Three is at the level of what? Body, isn't it? Three, five, etc. Please suppose that you have entered three bodies, five bodies, X number of bodies. So that Shruti seems to say that the wise person also requires a body. So one Shruti says that all he requires is mind. Other Shruti says that his desire of becoming manifold, that he only is one. How can you call him one only when he has one body? And wants to become three and five, etc. That means that that presupposes the existence of an external body. So Shruti Deha Sadbhavam Brute, that Shruti seems to imply the existence or the requirement of body, Deha. Tau etau Deha Bhavau Abhav Ekasmin Purushe Viruddhau. So there is a description of one person. The question is, in one place when the Shruti says that all he requires is mind to enjoy things, he doesn't that. At that time, he doesn't have body sense organs. Elsewhere, Shruti says that he becomes one and becomes three-fold. That means that he requires body for that. Tau-etau deha-bhava-abhava-au. The existence of the body or the absence of the body are ekasmin-puruṣe-viruddhau. They cannot coexist. To have body and not have body, these two cannot coexist in one person at one time, they cannot be. So these two passages describe one person or describe two persons? That's a question. And so when the Upanishad says that manasa etan kamalan pashyan ramate, is a description of one person. Say ekada bhavati, tridha bhavati, looks like description of a different person. Because they require different kinds of faculties, therefore, so purusha vedana vyavasthitihi. So pura paksha is there, this is a description of two persons. So either there is a wise person who only enjoys through mind, or there is another person who becomes one-fold, two-fold, three-fold, etc. Iti prapte brumaha. So all of this is deliberation upon. What is the result of this saguna brahma vidya? Which in different places Upanishads describe. And so how should we understand that? So here is the understanding of everything. Whatever Upanishad talks about, that's what we should understand. So Upanishads talk about upasana, those upasanas also should be understood how to perform them. So many sutras were dedicated to explaining the upasanas or meditations. And then Upanishads also describe the result of upasanas. So that also we should deliberate upon. So here is a deliberation upon the phala. So this is the phala. This whole adhyaya is phala adhyaya. Sadhana adhyaya, then phala adhyaya. So this chapter of Brahma Sutra is devoted to describing phala. Jivan mukta, videha mukta, etc. Whatever, saguna brahma, paravidya, paravidya. So therefore, there is deliberation upon the phala. So then Shruti has described the phala, the result of the meditation. In one place, Shruti says that he enjoys the pleasures by the mind, implying thereby that he doesn't have body. Elsewhere he becomes one-fold, two-fold, three-fold, five-fold, meaning that he has body. Therefore, one paksha is, this is a description of two different persons. It is a description of two persons because these two contradictory things cannot coexist. iti prate brumaha. Then Siddhanti says, ekasyavi purushasya kalabhedeto vyavasthito. So says Badarayana, Sutrakara says that no, this is a description of the same person. Kalabhedena, at different times, ekasyavi purushasya kalabhedeto vyavasthito. Because the thing is that as far as possible, we want to take the primary meaning of Shruti. Now, the Purupaksha says that if you take primary meaning that since these are two contradictory things, they cannot coexist, therefore this is a description of two persons. Siddhanta says, no, this can be a description of same person at different times, depending on what he wills. So, kāla bhedenato vyavasthitau ya deham icchati tada sankalpena deham srishtva. So, when this person desires body, sankalpena deham srishtva, the body is created by his mere will, tatra avasthitaha, remaining in that body, he enjoys. What? Jagrat dasayana bhogan bhunte. So, we have both the experiences. Sutrakara says that for our own self, we have to both the experiences. That we enjoy tangible objects with the help of the gross body, and we enjoy subtle objects merely in the level of mind. In the waking state, you enjoy things through body and sense organs and mind. In the dream state, all you have is the mind. So same person, in two different states, in waking and dream, enjoys things differently. So, why not a wise person also? So, jagrat dashayam iva, just as in the waking state, we enjoy things with the help of body and sense organs. So, deham, similarly wise person also, when he desires, he creates a body and enjoys objects as a person does in the waking state. Ya deham na icchati, doesn't want the body. Ta sankalpayena tameva deham upasamhrutya. Then by his will, he again folds up that body. Supna dashayamiva manasayava bhogan munte. And like the dream state, he enjoys the pleasures by mind only. Tasmat ekasyavi purushasya aichriko deha bhavo abhavo. Therefore, this is a description of one person. Aichriko. It is as desired by this person. Deha bhavo abhavo. He desires deha bhava, presence of body, he has that. Abhava, he has that. So this is the Siddhanta. Well, you may wonder, why do you want to discuss this? But as I said, you must have clarity about what the Upanishad teaches, that's all. You must have clarity about what it is the Upanishad is teaching. If Upanishad has thought it fit to talk about these things, then who are we not to talk about it? That's the thing, you know. Upanishad has thought it fit to talk about the phala of the upasana, then we have to understand that. Whatever you want to do with that understanding is our thing, you know. But the thing is, understanding must be there. When you study the Upanishad, so this is what enables us to understand Upanishad. Otherwise, how do you understand Upanishad? Otherwise, when you study 7th chapter and then 8th chapter, when these two descriptions are found, if you think about things, then these doubts will arise. We may not think and so it will be okay for us. But otherwise, for a person who gives thought to this, these doubts will arise. So to us, it's okay. People are concerned, Swamiji, how long did it take for Lord Krishna to teach Bhagavad Gita? I forget it. So to me, it doesn't matter. That for them, it matters, you know. And did Lord Krishna teach all, did he recite those 700 verses? From what Shankaracharya says also, looks like that Lord Krishna taught Arjuna, which that teaching has been composed in 700 verses by Vedavyasa. That's the description of a Bhashya. So what does Bhashya Gara think? We don't know. Then you can't just see Bhagavan Vasa, you know. If that is a verse composed by Vedavyasa, you can't say Bhagavan Vacha. So these questions arise, we dismiss them, forget it, shut him up, you see. But people dwell upon that. I said, why, what does it matter? You would say, what does it matter? To us what matters is the teaching and not how long it took, etc., and who wrote and who did not write. But depend to some people all these things matter, you know. And so there may be some people to whom these things matter. And for them, there must be clarity. And so, for clarity, this is being discussed here. Okay, we'll continue tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Veda Vibhagine Vyoma Vadhyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.